So may I please come in?
Yeah, please.
Good evening, sir. Good evening,
sir. Good evening. Please take your seat.
Thank you, sir.
You're Mr. Shakti Avasthy.
Yes, sir.
Shakti, I can see that you are basically from Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow.
Yes, sir.
I can also see that qualification-wise, you did your BE in Civil Engineering, that is from BIT Mesra, Ranchi.
Yes, sir.
It was in year 2014, right?
Yes, sir.
I can also see that currently you are Indian Revenue Services Officer.
Yes, sir.
You're still a professional?
Yes, sir.
Where are you posted right now? You're still undergoing on training?
I'm currently undergoing training in Nagpur.
In Nagpur. Okay. So, you're not happy with the Indian Revenue Services?
Sir, I'm happy with the Indian Revenue Services.
Okay. So, why are you putting that extra effort rather than learning tricks of the trade in your center? You're spending time and energy in another examination and then appearing for another attempt for civil services.
So when I started preparing for civil services, the aim was to become an Indian Administrative Service Officer. So I believe that IAS would give me the opportunity to work at the grassroots level, which was my primary aim why I wanted to join the civil services. And due to this, I am willing to pursue this interview exercise.
Shakti, I understand that it must be some kind of a strategic decision that why you took political science in IR. So rather than getting into that well-learned answer, that why political science, tell me what's wrong with the BIT Mesra Ranchi that it's alumnus, the passouts from civil engineering graduate are not confident enough about their own discipline. That forces them to humanities and social sciences when it comes to civil services. I mean, you usually you won't find good medical science, for example, AIIMS pass out getting into sociology. They will appear with the medical science. But that is not the case with candidates like you. What's the problem?
Sir, taking humanities subject, especially political science, is more of a decision which is based on prudence, because a lot of commonalities exist between the syllabus of political science IR and the entire GS 124 syllabus, essays, and also the other issues like interviews. Regarding why medical science students are taking that optional more as compared to other engineers, so that's perhaps because of the way medical science is taught in their colleges. For example, they have a pass out test which they at the end of 5.5 years, which they compulsorily have to pass out, due to which we have seen that generally the medical science profession involves a much more rigorous approach, which is less in engineering, where we have to pass every semester. So also the practical application of what we study in colleges and in job, they differ a lot. So due to this, like when I did the job, I lost touch of what I used to learn in the colleges. So then when I pursued the civil services preparation, I felt that it's more prudent to take a humanities subject, which has a lot more linkages with the civil services syllabus.
You're currently IRS income tax officer, still learning the trade, but still tell me, one, obviously the major function of taxation is to get revenues, but taxation is also a social tool. It's a tool of social change. A state sometimes do use taxation as a social tool. Can you give me a few examples where taxation is used as a social tool rather than just a economic instrument?
Sir, the very idea of taxation has a social element.
That is fine.
Which is inequality.
You collect money, you spend somewhere else. That is different. I'm talking about taxation in itself. Certain sections are given certain advantages. Certain sections are taxed heavily and things like that.
Sir, like the exemptions which are given to trust, religious bodies, political parties, these are also serving some of the social issues. The exemptions given to Prime Minister Relief Fund and all the other related, like expenditure in science, is often exempted from the income tax. So this also helps in a lot of social issues. Also agricultural income, which is exempt. So these are some of the social issues which taxation also serves.
Since you studied political science and IR, can you tell me what exactly is the justification of allowing political parties to get away without actually disclosing where they're getting money from, as an tax official also, don't you think it is a forgery to the democracy?
Sir, yes, sir. Ideally, the expenditure of political parties, even before below 2,000 rupees, needs to be told. But in a practical country like India, where there are donations even to the extent of 100, 200 rupees, it sometimes creates practical difficulties. But yes, sir, ideally, every political party which is a part of civil society should actually disclose their income to as much extent as is possible.
And what is the justification of keeping political parties out of RTI?
Sir, political parties say that if they will implement RTI, there would be a lot of RTIs filed for intruding into their internal activities. Secondly, they say that since they are not part of the state and are not getting direct funding from the state, they should be exempted from RTI. Thirdly, they say that frivolous RTIs would be filed and internal functioning of the political parties would be exposed if they would be part of RTI. So these are some of the arguments which are put forward by the political parties.
What is your opinion on it?
Sir, I believe that political parties should be under RTI to quite an extent. Yes, some of the internal functioning, if they are asked, they can of course not explain them. But in general, in principle, political parties should be under RTI.
In a related but still a different issue, recently the government kind of threatened using of Official Secrets Act against press. What is your opinion on that? Do you believe it's good for the health of democracy?
Sir, Official Secrets Act should be used to a minimal extent. And in this particular case, there was no need to talk about it. It was not invoked, honestly. It was only a comment which was made in the Supreme Court. So it should be used to a very limited extent. Even the case where the document was leaked later, Attorney General clarified that document was not leaked. It was only a photocopy which was leaked. So before making such comments in the Supreme Court, even the lawyers from the government should be more careful in their approach.
Thank you.
Shakti, can you explain the today's routine?
Sir, today morning I woke up 8, I went to the gym, worked out, and later we had a change of guard by president which we witnessed, and since then I have been involved in interviews over the places because today is the day I've got free after quite some time.
Okay, so you have visited President House today. So what's your feeling?
Sir, I'm feeling excited.
Excited. Have you taken lunch?
Yes, sir, I took lunch.
Okay. Recently, a data came that unemployment status has worsened in the last 2 years. What are the reasons?
Sir, firstly, the increase in the automation over the years has reduced the number of jobs, particularly in the IT sector, several reports have showed. So this change is such reason. Secondly, the lack of recruitment from the government itself under the very idea of minimum government, maximum governance, due to which government jobs are also reducing. So thirdly, our economy is becoming more towards the consumption side and less towards the investment side. The investment to GDP ratio has decreased. The savings to GDP ratio has decreased, which has ultimately led to less credit growth. And less credit growth has led to less investments, which has ultimately led to lesser jobs. So these are some of the major reasons why job creation has been an issue in recent years.
One question. Everyone wants to India be a developed country. What are the ways?
Sir, economically wise, we need to increase our per capita GDP. In a social sector, we need to improve our basic and soft infrastructure like health, education, reduction of poverty. In the social sector itself, the issues of communal violence, mob lynching, and such kind of inhuman activity should also be abolished. In terms of the cultural side, we have to develop more of a composite culture. If all these factors would combine, we will have a developed nation in years to come.
Okay. So you are from Lucknow.
Yes.
And Lucknow has a very rich culture.
Yes, sir.
And have you visited Imambada?
Yes, sir.
What are the features? Can you explain?
Sir, Bada Imambada, which is also called Bhul Bhulaiya. So it's actually a Bhul Bhulaiya where a lot of doors open, but very less of them lead to the right path. Secondly, it has the largest congregation hall without any external pillar. So it does not use cement, it only uses local materials. Also, there are no external support like pillars. The walls are so thick that they are able to sustain the load of such a vast structure. These are some of the crucial points of Imambada.
What message we can learn from Imambada in our life?
So firstly, the very intention behind the Imambada was to help the people which were affected by flood. So it gave jobs to them. So first lesson we can learn is that in adverse situation, we can look out for innovative solutions which can help a lot of people.
And what about Bhul Bhulaiya?
Yes, sir. Regarding the Bhul Bhulaiya, if the vision is clear in life and if a person is able to face the adversity, then they can find out the right path for themselves and not get caught in the Bhul Bhulaiya.
Okay. One more question from my side. Lakhimpur Khiri. It is in the Tarai. What are the problems of especially Lakhimpur Khiri?
Firstly, some of the social problems like the trafficking of liquor from Nepal, Mahua, they call. Secondly, some of the communal issues in the region, particularly between Sikhs and the local people. Thirdly, the floods which occur in the region every year due to the release of water from Nepal. Fourth is the lack of connectivity in the region, because even today, Lakhimpur Khiri, the railway line is being built and it's the only connectivity from Lucknow is via bus. So that needs to be tackled. Fifth, in the again soft infrastructure, education institutes are very less in the entire Tarai region, including Lakhimpur Khiri. So that also needs to be tackled.
You are a student of IR and you have not mentioned the porosity of our boundary.
Pardon me, sir?
You have not mentioned the porosity of our boundary.
Yes, sir.
So, that is not the problem?
So it is a big problem. Hence, the trafficking is basically of the tribals in the Dudhwa forest. So a lot of trafficking is done of liquor, of the local materials. And that is a major issue of also the materials which are sent from the region. So it's a big issue.
Okay, Shakti. Mirage 2000. It was in news recently.
Yes, sir.
How can you relate it with Rafael?
Sir, I am not much aware of the technical details in this, but Rafael is a fourth generation fighter aircraft.
Okay.
And if I am not mistaken, Mirage 2000 was a third generation one.
Okay.
But I am not much very clear
and
on that.
Who make this all these aircrafts? Is it made by same company, same country or different?
It's a country is same. Both are from France. Dassault is the manufacturer of Rafael. I'm not sure about the manufacturer of
Mirage. Dassault is the manufacturer of Mirage also.
Thank you, sir.
Anyway, so after this so-called surgical strike, what kind of dynamics you see between Indo-Pak relationship?
Sir,
what new thing happened that was not earlier?
Sir, India, this time the new thing which has happened is that the strike is in the mainland Pakistan, in the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa district. Previously, the surgical strike was in POK. So technically, we could call it our own territory, but now it is in KP. Secondly, it has now indicated to Pakistan that the low proxy wars which they were indulging in before, that option would virtually be over now, because it has given a very clear signal that if they will have any low-cost proxy wars, we will retaliate with five times the force. Thirdly, sir, the nuclear bogey which they have been calling from decades, it has also been exposed. Because we have seen that how their reaction was and how successfully we were able to pick Wing Commander Abhinandan back. So these are some of the new elements which have been brought by these current developments.
Okay, fine. I'll put you in a situation. Let's say you are an IPS officer in a city and there are two situations which are coming up. Two immediate situations. One is acid attack on a girl in front of a woman college. Another is mob lynching of a particular person. You have resources at your disposal. You will divert the resources to both incidents. But what is your priority? Where you will go personally? Mob lynching or acid attack? If you have to choose one.
Sir, I believe it's difficult to choose one, because both involve the dignity of their individuals.
But still, I mean, you are doing justice by sending your team over there, but you can be present at only one place. So what would be that place?
Both places.
Okay, let it be. In your view, what is the biggest environmental challenge right now?
It's a climate change.
Climate change. And recently in India, to deal with this all greenhouse gas emission and climate change things, we are basically promoting electrical vehicle.
Yes, sir.
Electric vehicle. We have national plans about it also. But what I see that when you put the electric vehicle on the road, you are basically shifting the pollution from road to the power stations, because the power that we generate, that is largely coming from the thermal power plant. So, I mean, what is the rationale behind it? Why to do that?
Firstly, the amount of pollution, if we took in comparative sense, it would be less in vehicles. Yes, this is true that power plants also pollute, but then electricity can also be generated by the solar cells that can be used in the batteries, which can be run to, which can run. So this is first difference. And even if you look in the comparative terms, the amount of double pollution and the different kind of pollutants like PM 2.5 and SOx, all the different kind of gases, comparatively speaking, the pollution in electric vehicles should be less. But yes, sir, ideally, over the years, we have to move towards renewable energy sources, and solar cells, wind are definitely the options which we have to look for in the future.
Okay, one last question. India, we have food security. Why not nutritional security? It's high time. I mean, we are living in 2019 and we should go for the nutritional security. So what are the challenges? Why government is not so keen to provide nutritional security all across the generation and all across the population?
Government is providing it in more in an indirect manner. For example, the milk which is provided in the midday meal scheme, that is aimed towards reducing the hidden hunger and malnutrition. Secondly, we also last year launched a national nutrition mission. That was also a step in that direction. Moreover, the additives which are given and the additives which are generally given, they are to ensure that nutrition security is also there. So in a way, we are providing nutrition security, but yes, we need to be more clear in our vision. And even in the national food security mission, we can include things like milk and things like pulses in the future, so that this vision is strengthened.
But food security, we passed in parliament. Put it like an act.
Yes, sir.
We can go with the national security also.
So in the future, we will definitely go in that direction. Indirectly, we are already doing a lot of work in that.
Well, Shakti Mohan, which activity in general is called social activity?
Any activity which helps the society in general at large.
What is society?
So society is the surrounding, is the people, is where we live. So it's the place where we interact with others.
Okay, so what are your core areas related to social activity, the one that you are involved?
I along with group of friends, we run a social initiative where every month one of us selects one social cause and then we contribute to it.
So what are those social causes?
So sir, like for example, in the month of January, one of my friend who lives in Uttamnagar, so he decided to renovate the park which was in front of his house, which was previously used by only drunkards in the night. So he renovated it entirely and all of us contributed to that social cause.
Okay, fine. So one major problem that is related to social activity is increasing problem of casteism in India. How do you resolve casteism, and particularly in the light of increasing Dalit consciousness?
This problem needs to be tackled. Since it's a social problem, so social ways needs to be taken to tackle this issue. The idea of sensitization of people, inter-community marriages, promotion of them, usage of movies and music, if these things would be created.
But the question is, increasing Dalit consciousness is related to their identity, and they particularly do not want this kind of mixing. So how do you resolve?
Mixing is not necessarily bad. Rather, the very idea of reservation to provide them economic empowerment was to mainstream the identity of Dalits. So that should be the way forward. Yes, the identity of Dalit pride should also remain there. But overall, intermixing might not be a very bad idea, because we have generally seen that as and when people get in the mainstream, their alienation is reduced.
Well, Dr. Ambedkar, he talked about of caste annihilation. Whereas there has been some movements in the name of Dalit identity, and they wanted the maintenance of Dalit identity forever, conceding that it is prior to Hindu Dharma. So, do you find some dichotomy in these two?
Sir, dichotomy depends on the way we look at Dalit identity. If we will look at it as something inferior, then there can be dichotomy. But if we look Dalit pride not as something which is for downtrodden, but rather we look it as any other identity of India, then it is not contradictory. There can be Dalit identity as well as their intermixing with the other communities.
But the thing is that if they would make it their pride that they are Dalit, so Brahmins, they would make their pride, and other caste members, they would make their pride. So in a whole, it is going to increase casteism.
Yes, but sir, suppose a Brahminical identity can also be equal to the Dalit identity. If there are two identities which are equal and which are seen as equal in the society, the problem of one pride being superior to other won't arise. So this needs more a sensitization, because even if we look at the Varna system in general, which was in the earlier Rigvedic times, there was equality between different Varnas. So if we have that kind of outlook, that would be that would also allow intermixing and will also allow different identities and their pride to flourish.
Okay, okay. So what are the major problems related to women and particularly social problems?
Sir, the very less sex ratio and the child sex ratio due to the female infanticide, that is first issue. Secondly, the crimes against women is the second issue. Thirdly, the lack of dignified behavior like the glass ceiling in corporate sector or the feminization of agriculture. These kind of issues are the other issues.
So do you think that reservation policy can bring some resolution?
It can certainly make a beginning in that direction. But again, any social problem can ultimately be tackled by social change. So reservation can act as a boost, act as an initiator. But until there is no social sensitization, the problem will sustain.
It is said that for the resolution of the problems related to women, there is the equal involvement required from both sides, male and female. So what is the possibility of the same in India?
Yes, sir, possibilities are immense, and it will again depend on the way sensitization of men happen. If they will consider women as equal partners in decision making, this will happen, and gradually this change is happening.
Okay, when do you think they would consider?
Sir, it is gradually happening in the cities, but yes, over as and when we are realizing that women are excelling in different fields, are doing so well, so gradually there is a sensitization which is happening. This needs to be this needs to go also in the villages and the places where it is still lacking.
Can you tell me exact time? I mean, 10 years, 20 years, 50 years?
Sir, it's difficult to tell, but certainly in the coming decades, we will see changes happening.
Shakti, you have also worked in Algeria.
Yes, sir.
So Algeria was a colony of which Western country?
France.
France. And when did it get independence?
So 1962.
Okay. And Algeria is also facing a lot of internal strife. So
yes,
what is the problem there?
Sir, the current president of Algeria, Mr. Abdulaziz Bouteflika, he is president from like past 20 years. Hmm. But initially,
which is very common in Africa, almost every.
Sir, it is common, but the problem is that when the emergency was lifted, de facto lifted in the late 1990s, so it was decided in that constitution that a president will have only two terms. However, this two-term limit was abolished in 2009, and he has been president ever since. So there is a general discontent of this particular move, which was taken a decade back. Secondly, sir, even when I was there, there was discontent on the issue that he was hardly seen. He was not seen in the public. He was not visible. So because of his ill health, so some of the intelligence agencies of Algeria, it was seen by the general public that they are exercising the real power, which was again creating a discontent in the media and the general public.
What is the Sahel region? Sahel region?
Sir, this region is the region of the mid part of Africa, which generally includes the Saharan Desert.
And who are Tuaregs?
Sir, they are a tribe in these particular regions.
They are also facing some insurgency issues?
Yes, sir. Particularly some of the regions like Nigeria, Mali, these are some of the areas where there is a problem of insurgency.
Okay. Recently, there has been a controversy over the French team winning the World Cup. So somebody has commented on social media that it is not France which won the World Cup, but it is Africa which has won the World Cup. So as a person who follows football, what is your view?
Sir, I do not prescribe to this view, because the players who were if this argument was basically because 7 to 8 players of them were black. So it was an argument which was a little parochial in nature, because players like Pogba or Samir Nasri, their parents have lived in France since 4 to 5 decades. And secondly, sir, this is much more common in Europe. Even if you look at the team of Germany, it also had 5-6 players which were from African origin.
Are you aware of the Tobit test?
Pardon me, sir, I'm not aware.
To test nationalism when some countries are playing, and maybe you are a naturalized citizen of that country, but you support the country from which you actually belong.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Recently, there has been a lot of hostility between India and Pakistan, and some people have voiced an opinion that maybe to put pressure on Pakistan to stop terrorism, India should actually let go of its obligation under the Indus Waters Treaty. What is your view?
Sir, this is a very difficult thing to implement, because we can't create dams overnight, even if we wish to have any change in the Indus Waters Treaty. Secondly, even if we look at the clause of the treaty, we are not using the entire Eastern Rivers in itself. So if we start using them, then it should be a first step, but even we are not using that. Thirdly, sir, even if we have a stopgap arrangement where we actually stop the waters of Western Rivers, there will be flood in our own area of Kashmir. So this is an idea which has a lot of implementation issues.
Shakti, tell me, what is the difference between liberalism and libertarianism?
Sir, the difference lies in the extent of liberty which both of them talk about. Libertarians talk about the extreme form of liberty. So, for example, scholars like Robert Nozick, they say that even things like fire, ambulances, police, they should also be under the private control. However, liberalism has its own schools, and most of the schools talk about the freedom in trade, business. However, this extreme kind of freedom is generally avoided in liberalism.
Tell me, what is the problem with this contempt of court provision? Why it is in controversy all the time? What is problematic about it?
So generally, the contempt of court is a little misused, if I may call so, because the Contempt of Court Act and also several of the guidelines given by the Supreme Court, they have a broad understanding that the activity of the person should not interfere with the proceedings of the court. However, sometimes even criticism of the judges or the court has been...
Does it also go against principles of natural justice?
Yes, sir. Because no judge should be... no person should be a judge in his or her own court. But
last,
then, sir...
Last question to you. You come from Uttar Pradesh. And we have seen in recent past that there are many places the name have been changed.
Yes, sir.
What is your opinion? Is it a good policy on the part of the government, or they are not taking care of the sensitivities of all sections of the people?
Sir, we have to look on this on a case-to-case basis. If there is some historical justification, and if there is a genuine public demand or some rationale which allows it, then we can go ahead with the name changing. It is not bad per se, but the intentions and the situation circumstances have to be seen for every case.
Shakti, since you like street theater, tell me, what is the role of IPTA in the cultural emancipation of the country?
Pardon me, sir, I could
IPTA. You have heard the word IPTA or not? Indian Progressive Theatre Association?
Yes, sir, I have heard the name.
Yeah.
So, Sir, as per my understanding, it was formed in late 1960s, 70s with the left-wing ideas. And Mr. Prithviraj Chauhan and those time Mr. Bimal Roy, these people used to have them. I'm currently not sure of how relevant they are currently, but certainly they were very prominent and helped a lot in awareness of the social issues, particularly in 50s, 60s and 70s.
There was a time when the street theatre and theatre movement in general was an important barometer of people's perception and opinion. Now the same role is taken by social media and things like video streaming. Do you believe there's a future of street theatre?
Yes, sir. I believe there is a future of street theatre if they improvise. For example, sir, even in US, the Broadway theatre, despite all the improvement in technology, Broadway theatre is still an affair which is liked by the people. So they have to renovate. For example, if now there are some such theatre acts where the audience tell the actors on what the ending should be, and the actors are performing that ending on the spot. So if such kind of innovations are being brought by the theatre themselves, they will stay relevant because, sir, there is no alternative to live experiences. And as and when we'll find that people would like to have more niche experiences, if the theatre adopts to them, certainly they have a future.
Good, Shakti. It was very nice talking to you.
Thank you,
sir. You can leave now.
Thank you, sir.
Sit down, Shakti. So, what do you say? How was your performance in the interview?
Sir, I think I did fine.
Okay. And generally, what was your score last time?
160 I got last year.
160. And how is your mains this time?
Sir, it was better than previous
year. Better than previous year. Why you got only 160?
Sir, I felt that the chairperson asked me only one situational question regarding street play, and then he got a little bit disinterested. So there was no cross questioning from his side, and then the other panelists started asking questions. So I felt that maybe at one question he only asked me. So I think that was the reason.
From the word go, it was average kind of thing.
Yes, sir. I think the first 2-3 minutes I lost an opportunity. I did try to improve my answers, and I did in the coming questions. But that time he felt that I am an average candidate.
Our understanding of the interview, I mean, and the discussion that followed your interview suggests that you are definitely a very good candidate, and your performance by and large is really good. Talking purely in terms of technical parameters, your sitting posture is good, your voice level is good enough, your hand movement is also good. Eye contact sometimes appears that you can still do a bit better, especially when you are your thinking posture. When you're thinking, your eyes, you break your eye contact and look upward. Our suggestion always is either you look at the person you're talking to, and if for some reason you have to break the eye contact, you should actually be looking down rather than looking up. That is always helpful. Your flow is good. You do have vocabulary. The strength you have is basically your analysis. So it's all boils down to the nature of the interview. If the interview is analytical, is conceptual, you're gonna do very well. If it is getting factual, okay, you'll be doing average. You'll doing below that. But for you, the positive thing will be that you should. You are already in a position, since you are already selected and you are in service, you can try leading answers so that you actually take the person, take the board to, you shouldn't be using it indiscriminately, but sometime you can actually get into the leading answer and taking the board member to the area of your strength. This I'll advise you to do, you can do. Otherwise, you, in my opinion, you're really doing well. Almost every area we talked, you do have some opinion, except that obviously the situation thing. I don't know why you got blank on that, because either way you could have
How should I
see that? That was a very pretty common situation we generally ask when you cannot be at two places. You have to look at the impact of your presence. Your impact on the position obviously will be better at the mob lynching thing, because mob lynching can spiral out to a bigger violence. And also the mob lynching unfortunately have some kind of a social sanction, which is not the case with the acid attack thing. Acid attack, even a constable can stop, because there is no public support to the, there'll be only 1, 2, 3 person who will be doing a crime. That's it. That is not the case with mob lynching. Mob lynching has some social sanction. So you may actually need decision making at that spot. So it makes sense to be at mob lynching. This is what, though it is sensitivity versus administrative acumen, but obviously the better sense suggests that you should be there. But even if you said mob, say the other thing, you should have said at least, because even the getting blank on such situation is not the best way of doing it. But otherwise, you are really doing well, in my opinion. You'll be doing a lot better than 160, a lot better than 160. Okay?
Thank you.
All the best.
Thank you, sir.